This module is on collision theory and the Arrhenius equation. So basically, how do chemical reactions occur? We know about the mechanisms now, but you know what has to happen for that elementary step to happen. And we're also going to talk about how the rate constant depends upon temperature and activation energy. So it ends up that rate constants almost universally increase with increasing temperature. So in general, if you plot the rate constant K versus the temperature in Kelvin, you get a curve looks something like that. It increases exponentially. Well, why? By increasing the temperature, that means that the molecules are moving faster, which means that they're going to collide more often with a greater frequency. And so the more often they collide, the greater the chance they have of having the chemical reaction occur. But it ends up that the reaction rate's less than what the calculated collision frequency is. So we can calculate how frequently these molecules will collide at a given temperature and so on. And it ends up that the rate of reaction is less than that. In other words, every time they collide, they don't react. Why is this? Well, a scientist named Irenaeus proposed the existence of what's called an activation barrier, or an activation energy. So the idea is this, that so for this reaction here, okay, two of these molecules must come together for this step to happen. And these are the products right over here, nitrogen monoxide and bromine. And this is an exothermic reaction, but the same thing applies to an endothermic reaction. This is exothermic because the energy of the products is less than the energy of the reactants. But in order for them to react, Arrhenius proposed that they must have enough energy to get over this barrier, the difference from here to here. So they need at least this much energy when they come together for them to react. If they don't have that much energy, they just bounce apart and nothing happens. And also Arrhenius proposed the existence of something called a transition state. As these two molecules hit each other, they have enough energy, they start to react, and as they do, they form this transition state between the separate reactants and the separate products, some temporary transition state. So this distance from here to here, again, activation energy. So this is just a picture of what's going on with the activation energy and the transition state. So if we look at a reaction at two different temperatures, and if this amount of energy is the activation energy, in other words, when the molecules, the reactants, come together, they have to have this much energy or more in order for the reaction to occur. So at one temperature, the curve looks like this. Number of collisions, you know, on this axis, energy on this axis. So everything under this curve right here has enough energy to react. At T2, the curve looks like this. There's a greater energy, okay, more of the molecules have enough energy to react, and we have more of them reacting, getting over the activation barrier. But even with that taken into account, it ends up that taking the activation energy into account, that the rate of reaction is less than the rate of collisions. So every time they collide with enough energy to get over the activation barrier, what this means is they don't always react. Why is that? Well, it ends up that they also have to, in addition to having enough energy when they come together, they also have to have the correct orientation. So in this picture here, okay, in order for these molecules to react, the bromine atoms are going to hit each other, and it happens. This is another possible orientation where they hit and a reaction happens. But if they collide like this, the two oxygen atoms hitting each other, then the bromine atoms can't react and there's no reaction. So to summarize, in order for a reaction to occur, this is collision theory, the reactants must have enough energy when they collide to overcome the activation energy, and they must collide with the correct orientation. We can write this down in an equation, so that the rate constant, okay, is, you know, how fast the reaction happens, is equal to what's called the collision frequency times the steric factor times this exponential function. Z is the collision frequency, P is called the steric factor, and it's always less than 1, and it's just taking into account the orientation. But don't worry about it. We're going to look at a simplified form of this, the Arrhenius equation. So if we combine the collision frequency and the steric factor into 1, we call this A, or the Arrhenius factor. And this is the Arrhenius equation. You should know this form of it. There's a couple forms we're going to look at. And in this equation, E sub A is the activation energy in joules per mole. R is the gas constant in units of joules per Kelvin mole, so its value is 8.3145. And the T is the temperature, and again, it has to be in Kelvin. Memorize this. If we take the natural log of both sides, we get another useful form of the Arrhenius equation. Natural log of the rate constant equals negative EA over R times 1 over T plus natural log of A. Well, why do we do this? Because it looks like the equation of a straight line once more. So Y is the natural log of K. The slope will be negative activation energy over the gas constant. X is 1 over the temperature in Kelvin. And our Y-intercept B is the natural log of the Arrhenius factor. So if we plot natural log of the rate constant versus 1 over the temperature in Kelvin, we get a straight line. And the slope of that straight line will be the negative activation energy over R. So let's say we do an experiment and we get these numbers. We plot the data, we get this slope, negative 1.2 times 10 to the fourth Kelvin. It's real easy to calculate the activation energy from that. That's a good piece of information. All we do is we take the slope, which is negative EA over R times negative R, and it gives us 9.97 times 10 to the fourth joules per mole, rounds to 1 times 10 to the fifth, or 100 kilojoules per mole. If we have, okay, another useful form of the Arrhenius equation involves the two different temperatures. If we have the natural log of the rate constant at one temperature, okay, T1 over here, natural log of the rate constant at the second temperature, okay, T over here, and we subtract the second one from the first, looks like this, using the properties of logs and all that. We get natural log of K1 over K2 equals positive EA over R times 1 over T2 minus 1 over T1. Memorize this form also, it's very useful. What it does for us, if the way it's commonly used, is if we know the rate constant at one temperature and the activation energy, we can find the rate constant at the second temperature. Or, alternatively, another useful form way of using this equation is just measure the rate constant at two different temperatures, and we can solve for the activation energy. So, for example, let's say we know the activation energy for this reaction. It's 102 kilojoules per mole, the dissociation of dinitrogen pentoxide once more. And we know the rate constant at 45 Celsius, 5.0 times 10 to the minus 4th per second. We can find now the rate constant at a different temperature, let's say 75 Celsius. Okay, so here we go. A couple of things. One, make sure that you always put the temperatures into Kelvin. So this is 45 degrees Celsius in Kelvin. We added 273.15 to it. This is 75 Celsius, okay, in Kelvin. Now also keep your ones and your twos straight. This is one on top, two on bottom, two first, one second. Plugging in the activation energy. The other thing to watch out for here is make sure you convert the activation energy, which is commonly given in kilojoules per mole, into joules per mole. Divide by the rate constant, plug these numbers in, and we get natural log of the rate constant at 75 over rate constant 45 is equal to 3.32, three sig figs from this guy. All we do is take E of both sides, the inverse of the natural log function. We get E to the K at 75 over 45 is equal to E to the 3.32. And then multiply both sides by the rate constant we know at 45 Celsius. And we get the rate constant at 75 Celsius, 0.014 per second.